Hello, hello. How are you doing? So I didn't pay attention to Brian, which is nothing new, but when he was out here talking, but I did hear maybe a notion of like something coming up, some sort of big announcement, right? I got it for you right here. You ready? The tomb is empty! Indeed it is. Old Testament, anybody? No, I'm not texting. I save things, and I look them up later. Jump into real quick. We're gonna touch on something, and we're gonna touch on something else. We're gonna read some scriptures, and I promise to get you out of here probably, I don't know, 5 or 6. kidding. You good? You good? You guys look good. All right. I saw some people giving some loving out there. I'm excited. I'll crack this open now. So. One thing we're going to be the primary thing we're going to be talking about today, I just like taking you guys into the waters that I consider a little bit deeper, and this is one of them, something that's been teaching, it's been with me quite some time, and that is the principle and the precepts of altar building, and the reason we build altars, and whether you realize it or not, you have built many, many altars in your life, BC, and of course after your conversion. People don't understand that. I was actually watching a little bit of a video this morning about witchcraft and their altars that they build in their homes to kind of give you a more well-rounded picture of the good versus the light versus dark. But I do want to talk to you real quick about something. How many have ever seen an eclipse? I don't remember when it was. It wasn't a few years ago that we were talking about the Mayan calendar and how everything was all excited and everybody thought the world was going to end. And of course, we're still here. The Mayans missed it. Hit and swing and a miss. But here's the deal. Alignment is something for a Christian that is very, very important. I work at a body shop. And we've got these gigantic machines, sorts, they're kind of mechanical, about half electronic, that you pull up. It's a frame machine. And it's kind of funny for the novice that doesn't know anything, you think you'd put everything together and then like straighten the car out. But we leave the cars in the wrecked condition that they're in. We put them up on the frame machine, we kind of bolt them down and hold them in place. And then we put these big chains and mechanisms on, and we pull. We put a great amount of stress against this frame, usually, sometimes body panels as well, in order to pull that back in its rough condition before we will put the new parts on. And if you think about it, it kind of makes perfect sense. You can't put new wine in old wineskins, the Bible talks about. So you can't put new parts on something that's damaged. And I want to point out something real quick here. There's a lot of Christianity that wants to just add stuff to you rather than take you back to the beginning where you must clear up what had been. You can't just start slapping body panels on old beat up pieces of cars. I once bought a Chevelle and the quarter panel looked a little suspect to me. So we got to pulling it apart because it was rusting strange and somebody had literally taken a quarter panel and put it over another quarter panel. And I think when we're talking about alignment, it's very, very common for churches to just give you a bunch of stuff and expect you to just do something with it. If you're any kind of novice body man at all, you can take a quarter panel on a car and put it on and screw it in and body panel it over. And yeah, it'll look halfway decent. You adjust the door out, it'll be okay. But the reality is, if you don't correct what was, the Bible talks very specifically about this in the spiritual realm, that you're building on a foundation that's already flawed. Clear enough? Easy? So when we talk about spiritual alignment, I need to point out something real quick, that it is important that just as the stars and in our solar system, things align, they come into order and harmony. And go away. And then we see things in the heavens that are amazing. We see the movement of what God had created in sometimes very unusual ways. If any of you ever seen the Aurora Borealis, Southern or Northern Lights, you understand that when all things are right, when everything has come in alignment for the perfect scenario, you see multiple beautiful colors that God had created for us to enjoy. Rainbows are another thing. You don't get rainbows usually from a dry sky. There has to be a certain amount of moisture, and then when everything is aligned up, you see this beautiful rainbow that God offered back so many millennia ago. So when we're talking about alignment, we're talking about something where, again, I want to go back to my job. Let's say we're working on, which I have, we've got a 55 Chevy. And the body comes off and the frame goes on the machine and we set up measurements and we adjust accordingly. And I have to tell you that sometimes those old cars really are kind of stubborn. Anybody stubborn in here? You liars. So we fight with these frames and we have to set a bedrock for these new components or the renovated components to hang on. So alignment has to be true, and we'll cross measure and we'll take everything back to factory specs, and then we will begin to assemble things. I'll take you into the spiritual realm. The Bible talks about that our lives are built up precept upon precept. Okay? That the Bible says that a man who builds his house upon the sand, we all know the little stories and the little songs, that building will ultimately collapse because it's not built on the proper foundation. For I was working on a truck this week, they had the front radiator support. Whoever did the body work behind, but in front of us had things so whopper jawed they just cut a chunk out of it and pushed it over so the fender would hang, and they bolted it all together. Well, we don't allow that, so we yank all that garbage out and we pull it all out. And I want to tell you, jump back into the spiritual world. Sometimes when God is working with you and He's trying to get you to that bedrock foundation, you're going to be very uncomfortable. You're going to be very vulnerable, and sometimes, spiritually speaking, you're going to feel very naked. The little 55 that we've been working on right now has no doors, has no trunk lid, it has no doghouse, which is the fenders in the front end and holds all that on. It's just kind of a tub sitting on a frame. But what we have on now, the boy's been working on, and I was talking to my one body man, Steve, he's got about 300 hours in this body, just him alone. So when God begins to work on you, when He begins to align you, when He begins to straighten you up, I promise you God will spend an eternity to do so if you'll allow Him. Now, the good thing about a car is that old 55 doesn't get ticked off and jump off and roll down the road. So many of us Christians, that God, as God begins to deal with us, we fight Him, don't we? We'll put up kind of a boycott of what God's doing in our lives, right? He'll ask us, or he'll lean in on us and say, all things are permissible, but not all things are profitable, Paul says. So there are things in your life that she may be able to do or he may be able to do, but God's telling you, if you continue on his path, it's not going to be good for your growth. It's going to retard you. It's going to affect you adversely. So when we're talking about alignment, and again, I'm trying to belabor this because I got to lay this out. It's incredibly important that you understand that in the Christian walk, we should be aligned body, soul, and mind so the Holy Spirit that indwells the believer can speak and move through you. The alignment is crucial. The alignment is so very important. If you're not aligned with God, you forfeit the good he has for you. And I've met a lot of Christians that that battle with things that are common to this, that are common to the human man, whether born anew or not. They battle with depression. They battle with drugs and alcohol. They battle with things of the flesh, too numerous to mention here, that, to be honest with you, come from a unregenerative spirit or a place that you have been, that you have not fully cleaned, or in our case, torn down. So as we get into this, we're going to kind of reach into what an altar is and how that has to do with alignment. But now that I got your attention, let's go to the Lord and we'll pray and we'll get started. Father God, I love you and I praise you and I thank you for your people here. And we know that you have a mighty word because it's straight from your word. I thank you that I don't have to lean on my own understanding, that you are going to speak through your word to your people. And we believe today that you're going to impart wisdom, knowledge, and strength to your people. And I thank you and love you. And I know that you have messages for each and every one of us because that is your multifaceted way. I thank you for the band that's led us into your worship, into your throne room. And I ask that you bless them for their dedication. Be with us today, Lord, as we go through the scriptures. And all God's people said, amen. All right, we'll talk about another thing real quick. Say amen. You remember the story of Elijah and Elisha? Long story short, and it's found in Kings, 2 Kings. If you want to jump in there with me, we're just going to read two quick scriptures, maybe three. 2 Kings 2:2. Let's see, we're going to start in 2:10. I'll back up to 2:9. To give you a story, Elisha had done much. Elijah had done much for the kingdom of God, and he was old, and it was time for him to go on. So he was being followed up by the one who would be his, or had been his student, and will ultimately be his kind of replacement. So these two men are now talking. When they had crossed over, Elijah said to Elisha, "Tell me what I can do for you before I am taken from you." And he said, "Let me inherit a double portion of your spirit." "What you ask is a difficult thing," Elijah said, "but yet if you see me when I am taken from you, know that it will be yours, otherwise it will not." As they were walking along and talking together, suddenly a chariot of fire and horses of fire appeared and separated the two men. And Elijah went up to the heavens in a whirlwind. So here's what we're talking about. We are talking about kind of a Paul and a Timothy. Men that have been together and worked together for a long time, saw many miracles, saw a lot of things done. And this type of miracle can only, I promise you, this type of thing only happens when you are spiritually aligned with God. Essentially, God was saying, "Hey, brother, as we walk, you're really closer to my house than you are yours. Why don't you just come on home with me?" That's amazing. He was closer to God than he was mankind. So we're going to talk about some altars. I want to read some passages. I'm going to give you some passages. And we're specifically going to talk about building altars, and you'll understand this in a minute. 1 Corinthians 9:13, "Do you not know that those who perform sacred services eat the food of the temple, and those who attend regularly to the altar have their share from the altar?" Matthew 5:23, "Therefore, if you are presenting your offering to the altar, and remember that your brother has something against you, leave that offering at the altar and go, and then reconcile to your brother and come back." We've quoted that scripture a time or two. Genesis 8:20, "Then Noah built an altar to the Lord, and taking some of every clean animal and of every clean bird, and offering burnt on that altar. Genesis 12:7, and the Lord appeared to Abraham and said, to your descendants I will give this land. So he built an altar to the Lord and appeared to him. So what is an altar, you may ask? Do you think about it? We're not in a church, so we don't really have an altar, which is kind of a bummer because it would be a good way to illustrate this. If you all been to any kind of traditional church, you understand that there's something that you come up to, usually you kneel at. Catholic churches are kind of put up a little different. You kind of got an altar kind of thing, right? Like a kneeler right in front of you. But the principle is the same, but you get it. You come up front and you present yourself at the altar, symbolically, but it's important that we understand the methodology of altar building. So what is an altar? It's a body, it's a temple, it can be a person or an animal. It's also a place of sacrifice, worship, and consecration. It's a meeting point, now catch this. It's a meeting point between human and spiritual beings. It's a place where covenants are cut and vows are made. It is a gate into the spirit world to make a way for angelic traffic, a spiritual highway for angelic or demonic traffic. For this reason, it says in Genesis, for this reason, when men on earth raise a righteous altar unto the Lord, it becomes a gateway to heaven. An altar can be a place that can attract blessings or cursings. We're going to talk about that in Exodus. Depends on the spirits that are evoked to consume the sacrifice on it. So here's the deal. So when you're lost, all right, Poe, bring this in. Clarify this for me. What are we talking about? So as you were, before you were, had come, those of you who are born again, in your life, there are places that you built altars. Some of you built altars on Jägermeister. You set up a spot, you set up a thing, and when you present yourself before that, there is a link. Some of you, it was perversion, it was sexual immorality, where this is where you worshiped. And we kind of think, again, worship's kind of got a mentality that it's a thing you do before God, but how many of you know you can worship anything? Anything that you put an enormous amount of consecration or praise or adoration, you become a worshiper. The Bible said that God is a spirit and must be worshiped in spirit and in truth. Say amen if you're still with me.
Amen.
Thank you. So an altar can be something, it can be tarot cards. It can be cursings, it can be spelling. Literally speaking, there are those who practice, who dabble, because there's no true witches are few and far between. I've known of many of them, and I know people that claim to be, but there's many, many dabblers. And some will go, you'll go in their house, and they'll have this area dedicated, set apart, right? These are the terminologies we're going to use. Dedicated and set apart for a specific action. So they will burn the black candles, they will smudge with sage, these things set up, and I won't go into all that, but you get the point that there's a place where they go to present themselves, to link with whatever spirit they want. Some of you have linked through heavy metal music. No, heavy metal music is not of the devil. But some of you have linked that also through country music. You could never link through Barry Manilow, I don't think. Possibly. Maybe John. I don't know. There are places that transcend and take you to a different place. Some of you have linked through Dungeons and Dragons. Some of you have linked through softball games and baseball games with your children. Do you understand me? You get where I'm, are you smoking while I'm rolling?
Yes.
We can set up altars that put themselves before God, a place where we present ourselves. Now, you can also, in your business practices, build up altars that have nothing to do with God, that have to be torn down. If you are a shady businessman, you have constructed an altar to make money. Your lies, your manipulation, the things that you do, the things that you've offered yourself up to, you feel me? You've offered yourself up to lies. Used car salesmen come to mind, but again, it's all in the heart. It's not the people, it's the heart. If you just want to make money and you're telling that guy, clearly this car has never been in an accident back before Carfax, a lot of this stuff could be covered up and now you can check things. But if you've offered yourself up to unrighteous living, you have built an altar where you have linked yourself with one spirit of the other. If it is I've built an altar and I don't believe in Jesus, but I've built an altar to help people. I built an altar to do good for people. It's still an altar. A place where you've gone to consecrate yourself for a specific action. In the world, before you know Jesus, before you've asked the Holy Spirit to infill you, there are things that you've done. There are places that you go back to. Sexual liaisons you had, drug activity you've had. I set a pretty big altar up at Hare Arena. Stoned out of my mind many, many nights listening to music at Hare Arena. You've got, at some point once you come to Jesus, you have to agree that these things are wrong. Do you understand? You have to get to the point where we don't joke and laugh about the old days. We don't glorify in the things we used to do. I had a Christian woman one time, me and my ex and a group of us were talking and sometimes you share your testimony, but you gotta be careful because sometimes you're glorying and you're going back to that altar. Oh, I used to be an addict. Be careful now. Let's not go back and enjoy that again. Okay? You got to be careful. Paul said it's not even advisable for the righteous to even speak of what the evil ones do. That we should stay away from that. So you got to be careful. But this woman said, "Hey, we need to get together, hang out, and we can swap stories." I'm telling you now, for this alignment to take place, for you to move further with God, for you to be all and receive all that He has, you have to look away. You have to repent, and you have to be aware, which you will be now because you're hearing this, that you have to tear down these old altars. Some of you have things that were linked to the darkness in your closet, physically at your house, that stuff should be taken out and burnt. Uh-oh, went to meddling, didn't I? There are things in your house, old pictures. You got any old pictures of maybe an old love that you're still cherishing? Your prom date? Oh, come on, dude. You've got to be tripping. Now we're looking for spooky things in the closet. No, I'm not saying that. I've got many pictures of a lot of different people, but I'm saying if there's something you keep going back to, you're worshiping it. Do you understand that? You are going back and you're bringing that up and you're reliving that and you're offering yourself as a living sacrifice to that moment, to those moments. Some of you can't get over your exes. You've cursed your current relationship and anything else you'll have from this point on until you tear that altar down. Amen or oh me. We need to burn these altars. We need to break this stuff down. We need to break it up, spiritually speaking, like kindling and throw it in a fire and get rid of it because you've set up something that you always go back to. And you say, well, hold on a minute, Poe. I can't help what I remember. I'm not talking about remembering. What I'm talking about is when you go back and revel in it and you go through, and the younger ones don't have this, but you go through and you're going back and you're reliving those glory days with pimply-faced Bobby and those uncomfortable fumblings in the back seat of his 68 Chevelle, and you're just remembering. That stuff's got to stop. You have to get away from that junk. Old things pass away. All things become as new. It's alignment. You have to align yourself agreeing with God that that old dude needed to be born again because he was foul. He was wrong. He was bad. He was at odds with God, and all that crap's got to go. We will take you the way we are. That's what the heavy metal church is. God will accept you right where you are. But you have to repent. Repenting is turning 180. I was headed north. I decided to head south instead. That's repent. When you continue to think it's okay to come with all your addictions, with all your anomalies, with all your freaky, weird OCD things that the monkeys, the devils have put on your back. It's okay, come on. Come all you who are weary and heavy laden, and I will give you rest. That's it. But you have to know that that can't stay. And you can't allow it because you've built altars. I'm not trying to dumb this down, but do we understand that? If you don't understand where you've been, you'll never be able to go where God wants you to be. So we've got to begin to understand that altars built by human hands, tainted by dark spiritual things, have to go. Some of you still kind of go back to the old way, the old church way. Some of you with the PhD mentality that, well, I would never dress like her. Be careful. Judge not, lest you be judged. We got to let that crap go. You've got to divorce the old you. It's almost like, it's really almost like when you reboot a computer. I really truly wish that we could reboot our brains and our spirit, that we won't be haunted with all that garbage that we used to do. Some of us like to go often ways and many different times into the dark realms. Some of us were just very moral people. Morality will not get you to heaven. You must be born again. So you get it. Building altars is the first step to make our own lives. Psalms 24:3 gives us a good description of those who can ascend unto the hill of the Lord. They're talking about, again, we're talking about alignment. We're talking about where you come into agreement. The Bible says, how can two walk together if they do not agree? If you and God don't agree on what's good and bad, you're going to have a hard time aligning anything. And we shouldn't suffer from the slings and arrows without having the knowledge that these are of the devil. Paul said, I am not unwise to the wise wiles of the devil. I got him figured out. So what are the characteristics of the altar? I'm just going to throw out scriptures. I'm not going to read this because we got some stuff we got to plow through. Characteristics of altars. Altars have the power to bless or to curse. Numbers 23:1-30. Altars can also speak about generations. And I spoke on this last week. I'm not going to linger here, but generational curses, as I spoke last time, must be broken down. And you have the authority through the Holy Spirit now to break that crap down. Yeah, I don't know. My old man could drink, man. I'm telling you, that old boy could drink. He'd put anybody out. That's in you. And that's a curse that has to be broken. Altars stand as a memorial for those who raised them. Even the descendants of godly men who raised righteous altars are blessed by God's covenant relationship with their ancestors. I had the nothing to do with me, but in my family, on my mother's and my father's side, were pastors. One of my great uncles used to ride around on horseback throughout western Kentucky, and he was a minstrel. He would sing and play and preach. The altars he set up reflect onto me. You get that kind of stuff? the things that your family did back in the day. But again, man, you don't even know. My family, they're all child molesters and drunks and addicts. They're the worst kind of garbage you'll ever meet. You can break that in Jesus' name. You're not tied to what they were. Old things pass away. Say it with me. All things become as new. We can break those, and we talked about that. Praise and worship represented from the holy and the sanctified altar represent a sweet incense to God. The Bible says, I quoted this earlier, that God is a spirit and must be worshiped in spirit and in truth. Do you know the Bible says that God inhabits the praise of his people? Do you want to align yourself with God? Begin to praise him. Begin to throw up your hand. Begin to thank him that even in the midst of misery, he has an answer for you. Begin to agree with him, align with him, agree with him that no weapon formed against you will stand. You have to come in agreement. And some of you are like, I believe some of the Bible. I don't believe all that crap. You'll never ever be in alignment if you don't choose to have faith to align yourself with him. The Bible says lean on your own understanding. I get it. We don't understand a lot of what went on with the Bible, but you can't. That's where faith comes in. You don't have to understand the virgin birth, but you have to align yourself with it and believe that God would not lie to you. Amen? That's it. I don't know Noah and all that crazy horse stuff. I don't know if I believe all. I don't know that you have to believe it, but you have to believe that God's not lying to you. Amen? So to make progress, how do we do this? We want to build some new altars right now. Okay, so we're here and we're born again and things are starting to move, and we're still feeling some kind of way about some garbage in the past, and we're really trying to move on. So what do we do? So to make progress in this Christian realm, we must destroy the old altars and its priesthood that we're talking about. We're going to Judges. I'll be talking about a lot of Old Testament stuff. To obtain the inheritance of the Lord has given, we must deal with the old altars in our families, communities, cities, and countries that were raised by Satan. Gideon did this, and the Lord brought him into destiny as a mighty man of valor. The Bible talks about in Ephesians that there are principalities and powers of the air, that the enemy has a structured assault mechanism against your family, well, against yourself, against your family, against your community, against your state, against your country, against your world. They're highly organized, and they're out to do you harm. They have to be broken. We have to begin to tear those down. It's important that you, even if you don't want to, okay, as God shows you something in your life where you've put an altar up, where you've put something, maybe you got something hidden under your bed, metaphorically speaking, spiritually speaking, that you pull out when nobody else is looking. As long as you, if you're, how do we build an altar? If it's like, God, I don't even know how to build this altar. I'll tell you a secret about the altar builders of the Old Testament. They worked with what they had to work with. They worked with what they had to work with. Usually it was stones. The Bible says that we are living stones. The Bible talks very specifically that in your life there are things that where you can build an altar. Father God, I know that I don't have a lot of faith, but the faith I do have, I want to come back here and worship. You showed me in your Bible where John 3:16 said, for God so loved the world, he gave his only begotten Son, that whosoever would love, believe in him would have everlasting life. I'm going to build an altar there. I'm a whosoever. I'm going to believe that I'm born again. I'm going to believe that God has an answer for me. So we begin to build these, but you've got to tear down the old ones. You've got to obliterate them. You've got to agree and stop going back to your old ways. You have to repent. You must repent. You must begin to tear these things down. And some of you, again, I'll touch on it and I'll shut up about this, are physically going to have to clean house. Some of this old crap that you keep going back to, you know it. And some of you, I can feel it in my spirit. Some of you, God is showing some of you right now the things that you physically have to get rid of your house because you keep going back to it. Get rid of it. It'll free you up. Spiritually speaking, there are some things that you just have to, okay, so let's say you had an old relationship that was amazing and awesome, now it's over, and the one you're in is amazing, blah, 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 but there was a reason that one ended. You have to now agree with God that you're in the present, eh? You have to agree that the past is gone, like Steven Tyler said, it went by like dust to dawn. You have to agree that I'm not going to live in the past anymore because there's nothing there but dead men's bones. I'm done. I'm not living in a grave. So Father, I thank you for what you've done. I thank you for the life you've given me. I thank you for the things you've taken me through, but I choose to live in the present and I choose to make the best of my relationship and I repent of going back to that altar that I once had, even if it was healthy or not. I repent. And I ask that you free me of that. I ask that you help me tear that down. I ask that you take my want to and make it want this no more. And Father, I repent and I turn, I walk away, and I denounce the power of Satan he has to draw me back into that again. Some of you can't get past the drugs. Fought that for years. I just need a high. Just another pill. You've got to stomp that thing, man. You've got to let it go. You've got to stop these things. And God, I just like that. I like that feeling, man. You don't get it. Kind of an introvert. This brings me out. I've never had that problem, but I'm kind of a this and it does that. And you don't understand where I live. And I just want. No. He will give you more than you can even conceive if you say, Father, as much as I don't want it, I'm going to give this all up because I want to align myself with you. And you said that pharmacia is akin to witchcraft. And I know that's not of your Holy Spirit. So I choose to align myself with you and I reject and I break that yoke in Jesus' name. I'm done with all that garbage. Father God, take this from me. But one step further. And God, as I build the altar of where that was, I'm going to build an altar on forgiveness. I'm going to build an altar of repentance. And now when I go back to that, it's not going to be, oh yeah, I need another one. It's going to be, oh yeah, I stomp the devil's face in the mud right here, right now. That's it. You're building new altars. You're tearing this down and you're saying, no more. I'm done. I'm tearing that down and I'm building a new altar. Spirit of perversion, I'm done with you because it does not align with what God has given me. God said, this is what I want for your life. This is what I want for mankind. Anything outside of that is wrong. I don't care what the world says. I don't care what this current culture says. If it does not align with God, you must destroy it and tear it down, but you must build the new altar. Father God, I thank you that you're going to work with me and you're going to free me up from this. I thank you that I will be in alignment with you and that your Holy Spirit will begin to work through me and I will be able to give people the benefit of what you've done to me as I build this altar in remembrance of what you've done. I will come back here often and I will worship and I will give myself as a living sacrifice. Amen? That we can come to him. That we don't have to be afraid. One of the most important things we must do to build altars of righteousness is the location, is our location so that the Holy Spirit can enter through these gates to and change the face of your life. We have to open, sorry, butchered that a little bit, but we have to be able to open up these gates, these doorways of the Holy Spirit, aligning yourself with God allows you to receive from God. You guys know the story of the wayward son. You've heard it 1,000 times. He said, hey, Dad, I'm kind of bored with you in this joint. I want to roll out. I want my inheritance. I don't want it now. The guy rolled out, man. What he chose to do is walk outside the spiritual connection, the spiritual alignment of father and son, and go to something different. Go do something in this place 100% different. And at the end of this thing, he got to the point and he scratched his head and he's like, wow, even my father's servants have more to eat than I do. And he didn't say it, but he said it. He said, I repent. I'm going home. And he came home, naked, dirty, scared, hard lesson learned. But what does father do? He threw the biggest party ever. He killed the fatted calf. He put the signet ring on him. He didn't scold him. He didn't beat him up. We're so afraid we're going to get knocked around by God. That's the last thing on his mind he wants. He wants you to be more. Come back, turn away. And as he turned away and broke that altar of self, he walked back to, in this case, his father, which of course this all represents God and our returning. He walks back to his father and he builds that altar again. And that's where he lived. Say amen if you get me. I'm born, you driving you insane? All right. So also, an inheritance can be forfeit if not protected by an altar of righteousness. The Bible says that he is giving us, he will give you life and life more abundantly. Do not forfeit your inheritance by serving idols. And we talked about idols. Idols can be things that keep, they're just things that keep you away from God or have more importance in your life than God. Choices that you make that take you further from God rather than bringing you to God. If you mortgage an inheritance to the powers of darkness, you will forfeit that lot entirely. Deuteronomy talks about 8:19 through 20 and 9:4-6. Demonic spirits from hell will come through an evil altar onto earth to oppress and disinherit the people who invited them. These spirits work hand in hand with the wicked men, bringing troubles, sickness, and death to families, communities, and nations. The power you have to bind them and release them is directly proportional to your purity and the sanctity of your altar. So, power. Those of you who understand power, a short in a car's charging, Becky's car was, the battery just kept draining. It just kept draining. We couldn't figure out what it was. We had this little AC-DC adapter thing that we charge our phones in and different things. It's got a plug. But it was plugged in a hot line all the time, and it was continually running power, and she wasn't driving that car much. So we'd come out, it'd be dead as a hammer. And finally she figured it out. She's like, I've got something draining me. How many of you know that there are things in your life that are draining you, that the enemy, amen, the enemy is just constantly pulling out of you, constantly drawing power from you? And listen, you will become drained far before the Holy Spirit will, because he is unbeatable. He's unfathomable. Spirit, the Holy Spirit is forever at your aid and at your for you. But if you continually allow the things of life to drain you, if you continually let these things wear you out. Anybody ever just been worn out with life? Just the crap of life that you just don't ever get a rest? You're being spiritually drained. I get up from a nap, I want to take a nap. I don't ever rest. I'm always on edge. It's not of God. That's not in alignment with God. The enemy is out to hurt you. The enemy is out to jack you up and mess you. If he keeps you forever mentally, physically, emotionally, spiritually wrung out, you're worthless. If the salt loses its saltiness, what does the Bible say? It's good for nothing but to be trampled under men's feet. And I'll tell you, here's the thing, guys. The best way to charge your battery is to worship God despite anything that comes to you and to help others. Love the Lord your God with all your heart, soul, mind. Love your neighbor as yourself. That's it. That's it. That is it. You want to know how to build an altar? Stop being a dick. When somebody needs you, give to them. If you have money to lend, give it to them and don't expect it back. Witness to the people you can't stand. The sandpaper people, Becky called them. The ones that constantly get on your nerves. Do unto them as you would have do unto you. You know why? Because you at your weakness, and God is at his strongest when you are at your weakness. He told that to Paul. So as you ask the Holy Spirit, Father God, if I have to spend 2 more minutes with this cat, I swear to God I'm going to strangle him. You are at a perfect spot for a miracle. Amen? You get that? Well, now the Holy Spirit has to do it because it's not within your power. Some of you are pretty normal and you're pretty even keel, and God can do a lot with you because you just don't get riled up. Stuff doesn't sweat you. But those of you who are on the ragged edge all the time, you are the perfect ones to see these miracles. You are the perfect spot to say, God, I can't do this anymore. Build an altar. Father, I open the door right now. I don't know what I'm going to do. I ask that your Holy Spirit move. I denounce this feeling of malaise. I denounce this depression in Jesus' name. I denounce this agitation I'm feeling with this cat whose eyes I want to poke out with a spoon. I just ask that you take this, and as I offer myself up to you, I want to come here and worship, and I want to say, yes, I agree with you that I can do all things through Christ who strengthens me. And I appreciate the fact that you're going to love him through me. Amen? All right, we're going to roll through this. I'm taking too long. You getting something out of this?
Yeah.
All right, I'm going to jump to something real quick. Because I want to reiterate this. I'm going to get you out of here. Okay, so the steps in building an altar. That's a shame because there's still some good stuff there. Anyways, so the steps to building an altar unto the Lord, like I said, you've got to demolish the old altars and repent over your idolatry. In raising an altar unto the Lord, you must ensure that you are not building on an existing altar that was raised to Satan. You cannot build an altar on ground that has not been yet consecrated. You have to destroy that, okay? It's got to be torn down. You can't use a satanic foundation for a spiritual, a godly altar. That's why we begin with repentance. We must be very thorough. Repent first of your own personal sins and the sins of your forefathers. It must be identification, repentance, like kind of like Nehemiah had, Daniel had, and Ezra had on behalf of their people. And I know this is going to sound kooky, guys, but I'm telling you, you got to clean up. You got to clean house. And Father God, I had no control over what my family did. I had no control over what my grandfather did, my grandmother and all those folks. But I just want, and these are prayers, man. I pray these. I would pray these. I would encourage you to pray these. And now watch God work. Father God, I don't know what my family was into. But I want to break all that down. And if there are things that you know that they did, then ask God to break that. Father God, I know John was a horse thief. Grandpa John was a horse thief, and I clear that. I don't want that in my pedigree. I ask that you just clear that all up and let's move on. Let's do this. Let's get out of that. And understand that at that point you are standing as a priest or a king, pleading for mercy. You identify yourself as a king and a priest. Revelations 5:10 talks about that. That we have to begin to appropriate. The scripture that says, kind of in 1 Peter also, that we are a chosen generation, and we have to begin to speak this. We have to be real with this. Father God, I thank you. I'm aligning myself with your word that says I'm a chosen generation, a royal priesthood. The Bible also says in that scripture we're a peculiar people. Know any of them? If not, you're that one. Anyway, but you've got to. Again, I don't want you to think this is all some kind of weird mumbo jumbo spell casting. This is literally, you're a spiritual being first and foremost. And what we're talking about here is a spiritual action and reaction first and foremost. So you have to start there for the rest of it to align. That's the way it works. So we're going to go in some pretty deep waters right now, so bear with me. You have to address the deity in the name of Jesus Christ, calling by name. Spirit of perversion, I speak to you in the name of Jesus. I repent. I reject that. You got to talk to it. You got to speak at it. You got to speak to it, just like Jesus did. And I talked about last week when Jesus spoke to the lunatic of Gadara. He spoke to him and said, "Who are you?" And they answered back and said, "We are legion, for we are many." He busted him in the chops and told him to get the heck out of Dodge. So we have to break down these evil altars using the name of Jesus Christ of Nazareth. Add the word to God, or add the word of God as you know it, as these things come to you, and begin to tear down these enthroned areas. Acknowledge the God's right to punish the sin of idolatry, that you're saying, Father God, I give you the right in my name to begin to tear these things down and to break them out as I begin to act different, as I begin to agree with you, as I begin to align with you, and renounce the existence between Satan and those who built the altar. Okay, so a little bit of reiteration, but Father, I thank you that you're here, and I thank you that you've allowed me to kind of get this a little bit. I don't understand it fully, but I know my grandfather John was a so-and-so and did such and such. I renounce that agreement my family made. I renounce that. And what you're doing is breaking that generational yoke. Okay, you're breaking that down. You're getting rid of that, because that has nothing to do with you now. But the Bible talks about in all through the Old Testament that God would visit things for generations on people, good and bad. But you have to, that altar has to be established. So a lot of this is just telling God that you're trying, that you're doing the best you can, and that you really want him to come into your life and to clarify things. And that you're just going to ask him to help you put in place good habits, good people, good situations, godly things, godly music. Not that music is bad, of course, in and of itself, because they're just notes established in so many different ways. But the spirit of which these things do to you, the link, that's what you've got to be careful, because it can be, like I said earlier, it can be rock, it can be country, it can be jazz, whatever it takes you to, wherever it takes you to, break that and allow the Holy Spirit to cleanse that. So we're gonna close up here in just a minute, but I just want, it's just crucial that we agree with God that he can do all things, amen? We have to agree that God wants nothing but good in our lives, right? We have to agree that Jesus died on the cross so all this can be taken care of. And we have to agree with God that whether we agree or not, we're going to do our best to align with him and allow the Holy Spirit to move in our lives. And that we're going to try our best, that if the Bible says, thou shalt not lie, let's just go to the Ten Commandments for a minute. Let's just try to align ourselves with the Ten Commandments. you're going to be pretty good. All this periphery around you, if you can try your best, your level best, to align with the Ten Commandments and say, Father God, I thank you for your Ten Commandments that you gave us so long ago. And Father, I confirm that those are real. I confirm that that's that's the stuff, and I want to live my life by it. Help me now as I walk in your spirit, in the newness of my spirit. Help me to live here. Help me to dwell here. Help me to build this altar and to begin to tear this stuff down. Now, this is it's kind of as complicated as you want it to be, but the reality is simply that if you agree that God says he is, that he has sent his son, and that the Holy Spirit was sent thereafter to encourage you and strengthen you, and Jesus said when he was leaving, and more than I did shall you do, because I go to be with my Father. If you begin to come align with these things and agree, I'm promising you, you're going to see yokes fall off. You're going to see chains fall off. You're going to see things, but more to the point, people are going to see things in your life. I don't understand why you're so different now. Your witness will be silent, but it'll be, you do know you can witness without ever speaking a word. Our life should be a witness. How you handle things, how you respond, because I promise you, God has the ability to nudge the lost to pay attention to you, right? He will nudge them to, look at old Ronnie over there. Look at old Kip. Watch him for a second. Kip, I don't still understand how you do it. I would have flipped out. Well, let me tell you how I did it. There are opportunities, man. There are opportunities for the Holy Spirit to speak through and move in us. But you have to be aligned with him. You have to agree that you don't have the answers. And men, for us who never get lost, you have to agree sometimes that you're lost. I don't need a map. I don't need GPS. Spiritually speaking, we all do, right? I'm going to ask my band to come up. If you please, come out wherever you are. Band people. Yeah, that's you. Come on up. So like I said, I want to encourage you all, literally speaking, to build altars. And if you want a deeper teaching on this, we can probably arrange that, because I'll be honest with you, Becky and I have been talking about maybe some classes and some stuff, offering some things, kind of small group setting stuff, to get us further. Because listen, man, nothing on earth would please God more than for you to blossom here where he's planted you, for you to come into the fullness of the Holy Spirit, where you begin to function as he called you to do. You're more than conquerors through Christ who strengthens you. You just have to agree with God in the Bible about the things he said about you personally, individually. It's amazing. It's astounding. And as a people, we can take back our cities, take back our homes. How about we just take back our lives? Wouldn't that be something? Wouldn't that just be amazing? But I will tell you, a sacrifice back in the Old Testament was a messy thing. There will be blood. And sometimes, just sometimes, in your own life, as you approach God, the Holy Spirit will reveal the sacrifice sometimes in your life. This is what I need from you. So that's why God, when we take up the money, we need the money to keep lights on and whatever, you know, whatever we do with it. But God doesn't need your money. He needs your heart and your willingness. That's why we don't sweat it. The money's God's anyways, guys. How you appropriate to him, that's the blessing for you. Because as you align with God and he says, give, and it will be given to you, shaken down, pressed together, and running over. You must come in alignment. Some of us don't have a pot to pee in. We don't give. We just don't give. If you sow corn, you reap corn. If you sow soybeans, guess what you get? It's just that simple. If you're a constant jerk, people are probably a constant jerk to you. It's just that simple, man. It's sowing and reaping. It's not brain surgery. But I ask again that you consider the words I've said today. I ask that you consider looking into your life, look into your house, looking into your possessions and seeing maybe there's some stuff you need to clean up. I promise you there's stuff spiritually you need to clean up because we're all in the same space, man. We're all human, but he loves you. He loves you with a love that can't be altered. And the Bible says that no man shall ever take anything from God's hands. But we're going to pray right now. Every head bow, every eyes closed. We're going to do the old school thing. If you've never invited Jesus Christ into your heart, this is a place you want to be. And we're going to pray this together. So somebody feels some kind of way about that. But I ask that you would pray with me this prayer. Father God, in Jesus' name, I thank you. I thank you for the sacrifice that was made on the cross. And I believe that that was for me. And I confess Jesus as Lord and Savior. And I ask to be born again. And I thank you that that's it. That's all you require. And if you've never said that prayer before, this is your first time, you are now a Christian. Lights on. We're going to turn it loose, turn the band loose one more time. And give them some love. They're amazing. Thank you, guys.
With us in the wilderness, he's faithful to provide. Every step and every breath, we've seen that this is God in his holy place. This is God, full of love and strength. Oh, sing out, lift your voice and cry out. Awesome is our strong God, mighty is our God.
Thank you. Have a blessed day.